the double pole switch, and some extra copper. Some ends of some copper wire. And this is number 14 wire. So we'll start putting all that together, and we'll come back part out. So here we are. We are ready to start our assembly with the three pieces. Okay, the next step as we start our soldering process on the SO239s, as I said before, these are off eBay, but it really doesn't matter if I buy them off eBay or at a ham fest or wherever. I take a file and I scratch the center section right up in here of the SO239 and to take that nickel plating off of it. And then I also use sandpaper to clean the ends of the copper wire before I solder it. And I'll just put this over in this vise here in a minute and we'll start soldering these three together. I'll solder my center connector before I mount the SO239. Okay, well, here we are at our next step. After we've got everything painted, the antenna connections or the coax connections are now soldered with a little pigtail. Each one of these is into 14 gauge solid copper wire. And I did not show this a while ago. Most of you are going to know what this is, but if you don't, it is a very valuable piece of equipment. And they're relatively inexpensive. I got this one at Harbor Freight. I think they're less than $5. They're called a handy holder or a handy arm, something along that line. It's just two alligator clips, but it's very flexible. You can move it in different directions and so forth. Highly recommend that if you're going to be doing any type of this work. It sure beats trying to keep it steady with your hand. So here we are. We've got our three SO239s, our coax connectors. Now the next part is to assemble them and get everything inside our circuit box. Okay, so here we are at our almost final step. We've got a painted project box, but we're using a house conduit box for our project box. The SO239s have been pop riveted in place. The only change I made, I decided right at the last, instead of using the solid core 14 gauge, I'm just going to use the stranded 14 gauge. And I'm going to hook everything up here, and then I'll put the switch on, and then all I'll have to do is just set the box on top of it like that. So the next step is to get the double pole, double throw switch soldered in place. And of course, to do this, you're going to have this will go to one pole. The other antenna goes to the left pole. And the center antenna hot will go right to the middle. So you got your box is grounding everything, and your hots are going to go to the middle of the SO239s. The double pole double throw switch is going to be switching your hots from one antenna to the other. So we'll be back after that gets soldered. Now you can see everything has been soldered and these go all the way across. In other words, this is the hot to the SO239 here. It goes across the switch. The center or your common SO239 is here in the middle, and that's the hot on it. And then on the other side, that's just a wire there. It's not sticking out of that. But on the right side, so your double pole, double throw, when it's over on this side, it's going to be going to these two. And when you flip the switch, it will go to those two over there. And that's the reason for the double pole, double throw. So the next stop is to get this thing put together. And I'm going to do a continuity test on it and make sure you don't have any shorts. And make sure the resistance and okay is doing fine. So we'll be back after that and see where we are. Oh, there you have the completed antenna switch. Got your input, your antenna SO239. It's pop riveted in. I use pop rivets. I can take a Dremel tool if I need to, but something that that's this inexpensive, I probably will never have to go back into it. The only thing that might be is I may have to change this switch. However, I saw one gentleman, I did some research on the internet, and even though you probably can't believe half the stuff, as you know, but this one gentleman had had a switch very similar to this, and it was a small micro switch, something along that line right there, and he had been using it for 15 years. Well, I'm almost 60 years old, so if this thing lasts me 15 years, I'll be 75. I'll replace it once more, and that'll probably be all I'll need for the ride. But there you have a antenna switch made very easily, very inexpensively, and it turned out fairly well. Got the hammer coat paint on it. And the next time, we're going to go inside the house, inside my little closet ham shack, and we'll see what this thing looks like on the wall. Well, there you have it, the fully installed switch that's made out of an electrical box. And all you have to do is just switch it from one antenna to the other. This goes to one radio, this one to the other radio, the master antenna comes in from down below. This is a typical, or I suppose not very typical, probably on the very low end of what a ham shack would look like, but this is what I have for mine. Over here is a Yaesu FT840. This one is actually on loan from my brother, AI4QT. Above that is the MFJ 971 manual tuner, a little small QRP rig. This is a 20 meter MFJ, the 9420, and over here to the left is the 2 meter, which is a Yaesu FT2800, and it's the power supply below that is a 25 amp power supply that power supplies the FT840, and of course down here is the laptop that I keep everything on, and a copy of the U.S. amateur bands. I'm a general class, so that means I have to be extremely careful about which bands I'm working with and transmitting on. But there you have it. So this is, once again, John, and wrapping up something that's in honor of my uncle, W5CYF, which hopefully by the time that you see this video, I will also have applied for and received his call sign. So this is KF5DMI, probably signing off on YouTube for the last time, and the next time I'll be back on as W5CYF.